morning, friends. At the outset, let me welcome all of you and thank Dr. Jyothide for on behalf of Dr. Harish and myself for conducting this annual CME, and that too including us as part of the CME. So the topic given is Reliving Hope in Indian Clinics, HOPE 3, Optimal Statins for Diabetes. We all know that at least 80% of the deaths in diabetic patients is related to atherosclerotic vascular disease, mostly coronary artery disease. So I think becomes very relevant, optimal statins for diabetes. And the current recommendation is whether you have coronary artery disease or not, I think age above 40, a diabetic has to be on a statin. So it is come to that according to the AHA guidelines. I think, and the HOPE 3 study, I think from the Salim Yusuf group, had shown that the patients with intermediate risk of coronary artery disease, without coronary artery disease, I think they chose the relevance of the use of statins and controlling blood pressure with a combination of an ARB, candesartan, and thiazide, reducing the morbidity and mortality related in an intermediate risk population who has just a 1% risk. So I think to talk to us, I think we have Dr. Harikrishnan, who is a very dynamic member of the faculty of ACT-IMST, founder, editor, journal, pulmonary circulation, area of interest, coronary intervention, structural heart disease, pulmonary hypertension, heart failure, CVD. So I think let us listen to Dr. Harikrishnan. Dr. Harikrishnan, please.
Respected Professor Titus, who was my teacher, and thanks Jyothi for giving me this opportunity to be part of this CME. So the topic he has given to me is Reliving Hope in Indian Clinics, about the HOPE 3 trial and optimal statins for diabetes. So I'll be discussing basically about the diabetic dyslipidemia and its management. So when we come to mortality in diabetes, as Dr. Titus has already pointed out, cardiovascular disease accounts for about 61% of the mortality, which is accounted by coronary heart disease of about 46% and cerebrovascular disease by 15%. So 61% of the mortality in diabetes is directly related to cardiovascular disease. Now there is a change in terminology. The cardiovascular disease was a previously familiar terminology to us. Now the diabetic association has been changed to atherosclerotic cardiovascular disease, that ASCVD, which we will be discussing this term in the subsequent slides. So this is the slides you must be all familiar with. This shows the 7-year incidence of myocardial infarction. You can see the green bars are those with diabetes and the yellow bars are those with diabetes. You can see that when you have no diabetes or no previous myocardial infarction, your chance of getting a myocardial infarction in the next 7 years is only 3.5%. But when you have diabetes, it increases to, when you have an old MI, it increases to 18%. But if you have only diabetes, still it increases to around 20%. But when you have both, it increases more than additive, that it becomes 45%. So this is the data from the MR FIT. You can see the green bars are patients without diabetes and the yellow bars are with diabetes. You can see that when you have the risk factors increase from 1, 2 and 3, the risk factors increase the proportionately around 3 to 5 times when you have diabetes. Depending on the duration of diabetes also, the cardiovascular disease mortality increases. When the duration is less than 2, it is only 15%. But when it comes to more than 15 years, it increases to around 42%. So is diabetes a CHD risk equivalent? That is what we have been taught and we have been learning. So this is the based on this NEJM data, you can see that the middle two Kaplan-Meier curves shows that that is one with coronary artery disease and other with diabetes, they are meeting together. So it was concluded from this study that diabetes is a coronary artery disease equivalent. But subsequently there was a systematic review and meta-analysis in 2009 which showed that it is a huge meta-analysis which showed that this is not true, and the post coronary artery disease events had a higher event rate than patients with diabetes alone. So recently, last month, this study was published in Journal of Internal Medicine, which included 1.5 million people from North California. Around 80,000 new coronary heart disease events were followed up, and around 1 crore person years, very large study. That showed that this is the graph. The dotted arrows show that the first arrow shows that the top one shows those with diabetes. The second one shows with coronary arteries. You can see that there is significantly more higher number of events in those patients with coronary artery disease compared to diabetes. So that means that diabetes is not a coronary artery disease equivalent. And this also shows that when you have that also depends on the duration of diabetes. If you have a duration of diabetes more than 10 years, then it is the coronary artery disease equivalent. So the current understanding is that, so this was also concluded in the British Regional Heart Study, where they found that diabetes more than 9 years only confers an equivalent risk to coronary artery disease. So the current understanding is that diabetes mellitus is not a coronary heart disease equivalent, and only when it is more than 10 years, it becomes a CAD risk equivalent. So diabetes and atherosclerotic CVD, we know that there is a definite relation, and it is an important cause of mortality, as we have seen, around 60%. And dyslipidemia is an important risk factor for, we all know that it is a risk factor for coronary artery disease. So with this background, I will discuss the topic, diabetic dyslipidemia. What is it? What is the pathogenesis? Do we need to treat all diabetics with statins? Is statins the only choice? What are the target levels to be achieved? And what are the practical things which we do in the Indian setting? So diabetic dyslipidemia, is it different? How is it different from the other dyslipidemias? So type 2 diabetes, it is characterized by three factors: elevated triglycerides, similar LDL-C levels, but in type 1 diabetes you have the elevated LDL-C levels also, but shift to a small dense LDL, that is called LDL-P, and decreased HDL-C levels. So we will see the pathogenesis, how it happens. Diabetes lead on to increased free fatty acids and glucose in the system. It goes to the liver. It accumulated in the VLDL, and if it goes to the intestine, it increases chylomicrons. So this will get transferred to LDL and HDL, and when it gets transferred to LDL, the LDL will become triglyceride rich. Once the LDL become triglyceride rich, it will be hydrolyzed to form small dense LDL. When it goes to, it get attached with HDL, it is easily removed from the system. So the half-life of the HDL, triglyceride-rich HDL, will be much low. So finally, these three things happen in a diabetic dyslipidemia: increase in small dense LDL, increased triglycerides, and decreased HDL cholesterol. This is also called atherogenic dyslipidemia. So now come to the management of dyslipidemia and diabetes. Measure lipids at the diagnosis of diabetes and repeat yearly if treatment is not started, and if the treatment is started, you do at around 3 to 6 months, and you should obtain a fasting 8-hour fasting lipid profile, which includes total cholesterol, triglyceride, HDL and LDL. The ACC, the American College of Cardiology, American Heart Association, recommend risk charts. So this is the pooled cohort question, which is available in all in the internet in many areas. So they calculate what is called a 10-year risk. So your 10-year risk of developing an atherosclerotic cardiovascular disease. So if the risk is more than 7.5%, you need to be on statins. So that is it. The pooled cohort equation, if your 10-year risk is more than 7.5, you need to be on statins. So the lifestyle modification is the most important. We had a session in the morning about exercise. The smoking cessation is the most important, which will show a sustainable benefit in the long-term management of diabetes and diabetic dyslipidemia. Fat-restricted diet, low cholesterol, low saturated fat, trans fat fatty acid less than 1%, we all know about these things, omega-3 fatty acid, and alcohol in moderation. Aerobic exercise, brisk walking is recommended, and resistance training has recently been found to be, and these are all discussed, I am not going to those details. Coming to the pharmacological management, which is the point of our discussion today, we have the following agents: statins, the cholesterol absorption inhibitors, the SGLT2b, fibrates, nicotinic acid, and the newly introduced PCSK9 inhibitors, even though we don't have it in India so far. There are different trials in dyslipidemia. The heart protection study with was the initial one which shows that statins, if you give to patients, that will lead on to beneficial effect in improving the cardiovascular outcomes. So then came the CARDS, which is specifically for diabetic patients, 40 to 75 year patients with a no history of CVD. Around 3,000 patients were put on 10 milligram of atorvastatin and found that they develop less acute coronary syndromes, need less revascularization, and less incidence of stroke. The CART study showed the primary endpoint showed a benefit, also the secondary endpoint. Subsequently came a meta-analysis of statins in diabetes, more than 18,000 patients, 14 randomized trials, followed up of more than 4 years. There is a 9% proportional reduction in mortality and a 13% reduction in vascular mortality if you reduce the LDL cholesterol by 39 milligram per deciliter or a 1 millimole. So that was the data which was available. So statin therapy, there are two intensities of statin therapy: the high-end intensity therapy and the low intensity. The high intensity is atorvastatin 80 milligram, rosuvastatin 20 to 40 milligram. The moderate intensity is atorvastatin 10 to 20, rosuvastatin 5 to 10, simvastatin 10 to 4, 20 to 40, and pitavastatin 2 to 4 milligram. So we have the high intensity and the moderately intensity statin therapy. So these are the recommendations by the AASCE. These are depending upon the presence of risk factors and your age. So we'll discuss it one by one. So if you have diabetes and established cardiovascular disease, there is no question you should be started on a high intensity statin. Less than 40 years, you have diabetes, if you don't have any additional risk factors, no need for statins. If you have additional risk factors, you should be put on a moderately intensity statin or a high intensity statin depending upon the presence of the risk factors. 40 to 75 years, similarly, for additional risk factors, you should be on moderate intensity statin. Additional risk factors, you should be on a high intensity statin. More than 75 years, people think that why should we give at this older age? But there also the recommendation is no additional risk factors, you should put on moderate intensity statin. With additional risk factors, you should use your own judgment to put the patient either on a moderate or a high intensity statin. What if the baseline is less than 2 millimole or less than 80 milligram? The CARDS and HBS study has shown that still the patients benefit. So if the patient qualifies for statin therapy based on the algorithm, the statin should be given regardless of the baseline LDL cholesterol. So in summary, all diabetic patients except those less than 40 years without any additional risk factors should be started on statin therapy. So how do we monitor? The AASCE recommends to check lipid values every 6 weeks. Every 6 weeks till the target levels are achieved. After that, you can do it every 6 to 12 months. We do it around 3 to 6 months to ensure that the compliance is there. Liver function, you have to test at baseline at 3 months after initiation of the treatment and every 6 months thereafter. But the US FDA recommends at baseline only. And if the ALT, the transaminases are going up to more than 3 times of normal, you should reduce or stop and follow up significantly. CPK creatinine level should be checked when patients report significant muscle weakness or myalgias. Not a routine checking is recommended. Safety of statins, there is a concern regarding the safety of rosuvastatin in Asians, especially with the higher dosage. This is a recent study published in last month. 2,500 patients, there was no rhabdomyolysis. 1.88% only had myalgia in the short term, 6.4% in the long term. ALT elevation was only in the around 2% of the patients. So it is a relatively stable, safe form of therapy. What are the targets? AASCE lipid targets for patients with type 2 diabetes. If you have if you are a high risk patient, the recommended level is less than 100 milligram. If you have atherosclerosis, CVD, or additional risk factors, the level should be achieved is less than 70 milligram. So 100 milligram and 70 milligram. Triglycerides less than 150 milligram. Non HDL cholesterol, you add 30 milligram to the LDL level. ACC-AHF actually they have no set specific targets for starting dosing, as we have seen in the latest recommendations. But they also said that the LDL reduction, LDL-C reduction, more than 50% with high intensity statin from the baseline, and 30-50% with the moderate intensity statin. So in a patient who are not, who is not having a good response with statin, it is recommended that you can add a non-statin medication. So statin intolerance is a common problem. 5-10% of the patients will develop some form of intolerance, mostly due to muscle symptoms. The ADA and ACC-AHA advocate a different type of statin. A lower dose of the same statin, sometimes alternate dosing may help. Sometimes people have stopped and then re-challenged, the patient may tolerate that drug. If not able to tolerate the statin, switch to a non-statin medication. Whether the statins will further impair the glucose tolerance, that is another question. The meta-analysis of 9 RCTs of around 10,000 patients, mean follow-up of 3.6 years, it shows that there is a modest but significant increase in mean A1C level of 0.12%. So statins do worsen diabetes glycemic status. So, but some data on the pitavastatin. We know that statins induce diabetes. When you started on a patient without diabetes, there are a lot of discussions on that. Because of the lack of time, I'm not going to the details. But pitavastatin has been found to be not having that much effect on the new onset diabetes. Meta-analysis of 15 short RCTs, 12 weeks duration study, total follow-up of 1,600 person years. There's no significant risk of diabetes compared to placebo. So what will you do if the triglycerides are more than 500? You have to start, or you have to prevent risk of pancreatitis by giving fibrates and optimize glycemic control. Mostly the hypertriglyceridemia is due to many factors like alcohol, obesity, and dietary strategies. The second line agents, you should consider only if LDL-C target are not achieved with a statin or the patient is statin intolerant. Three agents are available: the cholesterol absorption inhibitors, fibrates, and nicotinic acid. Nicotinic acid, we know that further impairs glucose intolerance. So nicotinic acid is not, and to combine with statin, it will increase the toxicity. So nicotinic acid, not a very popular option. The one available is the fibrate and the cholesterol absorption inhibitors, the Improve It, acetimibe. The Improve It trial is the one which has recently come. Improve-It trial is the one which recently come. It showed the addition of acetimibe 10 milligram to a simvastatin 40 milligram showed a relative risk reduction of 5% and absolute risk reduction of 5% and a relative risk reduction of 14%. So in patients who are not controlled on statin, you can add acetimibe to get a better control of lipid levels. The field trial, which tried fibrate in patients with diabetes, did not show any benefit. 10,000 patients followed up for 5 years, the outcome was not very good. So the PCSK9 inhibitors, which are recently come, 25 randomized control trials, the meta-analysis of that shows that evolocumab or alirocumab LDL reduction very high, 36-59% reduction in LDL cholesterol, but you have to have a subcutaneous injection. This can be tried in patients who are intolerant to statins and very high risk of CVD and those who require to reach LDL targets. Now we come to the last part of the talk about the HOPE-3 trial, which was I was asked to present. It's a double-blind placebo-controlled trial by a 2x2 factorial design where 12,000 patients more than 55 and female more than 60 years who did not have cardiovascular disease were randomly assigned to receive cholesterol-lowering treatment with the rosuvastatin at 10 milligram and a 5.6 years follow-up landmark trial. The cholesterol-lowering arm was unique that no entry criteria based on lipid levels, no routine monitoring, no dose titration, with low dose of rosuvastatin of 10 milligrams. So this was the primary endpoint. I'm skipping that. You can see that a very significant improvement. P-value is 0.0004. Cardiovascular death, MI, stroke, cardiac arrest, revascularization, heart failure. Very significant improvement with lipid lowering therapy. This also had a BP lowering arm. I am not going to that detail. That did not show that much benefit. So rosuvastatin 10 milligram per day reduced LDL cholesterol by 34.6, almost a 1 millimole. Consistent regardless of LDL, SB, systolic BP, risk factors, CRP level, ethnicity. So excess in some minor increase in side effects, no excess in rhabdomyolysis, myopathy, or new diabetes. So statins benefit in intermediate risk patients without cardiovascular disease, 30% relative risk reduction with statins alone. This is a pragmatic strategy because there is no lipid or BP entry criteria or targets, no dose titration, infrequent safety monitoring. So strategy used in HOPE-3 is a simple, safe and effective, is a widely applicable primary prevention strategy. So newer anti-diabetic drugs, the liraglutide and limbaglifosin, very good cardiovascular outcomes. They are going to come as a second line drugs. So when the second line drugs come, how the statin is going to be in that place, we have to see in the coming years. So to conclude, take home messages, diabetic dyslipidemia, what is it? It is low HDL cholesterol, high triglyceride and low LDL, the high LDLP or the small dense LDL. Is statins the only choice? Statins is the first and the best choice. Do we need to treat all diabetic with statins? Yes, all patients X less than 40, those without risk factors, all others need to be started on statins. What are the target levels? 100 milligram. If you have CVD or multiple risk factors, it is 70 milligrams. If LDL targets are not achieved, we can give acetimib as by the IMPROVE trial. Statins are relatively safe, but we have to monitor liver and muscle side effects. HOPE-3 brings more people under the umbrella of statins. Thank you.
About pitavastatin, is the myalgia less? There are some claims that the myalgia is less. It's pitavastatin. Is there any such claim?
I don't have much experience with pitavastatin, but the study says that the overall muscle side effects are significantly less.
See, it's only used as a moderate intensity statin, yeah. Group, not the high intensity. So I think the efficacy is less and side effects are also less.
Yeah.
I have two questions. Looking at the HOPE-3 trial in terms of primary prevention.
Yeah.
In moderate risk, it can be given. So any male above 40 and little bit obese, should we give to all of them? I mean, this is what?
That is a controversial thing. If you have risk factors or you are an intermediate risk person, I think it is better to start on a low intensity statin. I don't think there is a, because it is found to be relatively safe. So it may not be a bad idea to start on a statin if you are having risk factors. At least two risk factors.
At what age? 40. Yeah? What did you say?
Above 40, that is what?
Above 40.
It's already there.
Above 40 with...
No, if you have diabetes,
it's already there.
Because age is a risk factor, male gender is a risk factor, weight gain is a risk factor, and we see all three very commonly.
Second question.
So I think most of the people sitting here will require a statin.
Second question.
Yeah.
Your comments about seroglitazar, you did not mention.
Indian molecule. Yeah, the Indian molecule, yeah, that's...
It's mainly for triglyceride. Mainly for the triglyceride.
Triglyceride reaction. Benefit. Yeah. Yeah, that's an Indian molecule, I think.
Somehow, I think it's not very popular.
Sir.
For the cost, maybe.
Sir, newer second-line drugs, how advantage over than others? Please explain.
Which newer? Anti-diabetic drugs?
Well, anti-diabetic. Two drugs you also.
Maybe the newer. Last question.
Yeah, liraglutide and embagliflozin. So they have embagliflozin actually increases the LDL levels, but in one way in the serum, but it actually reduces the LDL-C absorption. So in that way it balances. So that is how. But embagliflozin has actually a very good cardiovascular outcomes otherwise, other than the independent of the lipid levels. That is what it is.
So many of our patients found to be vitamin D deficient, already presenting with myalgia. Any dose titration required in the statin therapy?
Vitamin E, I don't know there is any definite data to say that vitamin E supplementation improves the myalgia outcomes. But many people symptomatically get benefit by giving probably a placebo effect.
I think what they suggest is coenzyme Q.
Vitamin
E was found to be useless in that... HOPE study. But I think coenzyme Q maybe. I think maybe one last question, if there is, otherwise we will wind up.